guys lock out 2 degrees centigrade? That's the question I really want to ask here. And I'm going to try to work out this that way around next. So I'm going to try to unpick some of the detail in the Paris agreement and also ally that with some of the science, particularly that that's embedded in the IPCC, and then do some really quite some simple arithmetic to say where does that leave us today. But I'm going to start out with this quote from Richard Feynman. Can you see the screen from the back? This quote from Richard Feynman, and this is his contribution when he was the president of the Shuttle Commission, looking into the accident on the Challenger. For successful technology, reality must take precedence over public relations, for nature cannot be fooled. And the argument that I make is that we, collectively as a society, and I include within that the scientific community, have been knowingly and deliberately trying to fool nature for at least 10 or 15 years on climate change, if not considerably longer than that. And I'll come back to that quote later on. Obviously, Feynman wasn't directly talking about climate change, but I think it really captures the delusion that we all share when it comes to climate change. I also think it's important, before we ever think about how we resolve a problem, to remind ourselves where we are today. And I think most of us, again, are fairly reluctant to acknowledge where we are in terms of the challenge. And only then can you start to think of what the solution space might look like. The mitigation message hasn't changed since the first IPCC report came out in 1990. Not a lot has changed really since then. We had everything we needed to know, we knew everything we needed to know about climate change in terms of mitigation in 1990, 25 years ago, a quarter of a century of complete and utter failure to address climate change. And I think we have to remind ourselves of how abject that failure, of which we have presided over, has actually been. The emissions this year will be 60% higher than they were at the time when we first pretended to care about climate change. 60% higher. That's success. That's what our success looks like quantitatively. 25 years and a 60% increase in our emissions. And the other thing to bear in mind is that the carbon dioxide concentration in the atmosphere that we see today is higher than it has been for at least 800,000 years. Now that is three times longer than we've been on the planet. So that is that again is a fairly sad indictment that we've brought about that sort of level of change, and we are absolutely certain it is from the burning of fossil fuels because it has an isotopic fingerprint on the CO2. So that's our backdrop. And I think, it's not meant flippantly, I actually think this quite seriously, that before we start to reflect on where we need to go, we need to perhaps hold our heads down and just reflect for a minute, perhaps a little bit of shame, that this is what we're handing on to the next generation. This is what we've chosen to hand on to the poorer people around the planet and our own children. And we have knowingly done that for 25 years, our deliberate inaction. So I think it's not a bad point just to reflect where we are today before we start to think about where we must go from here. And by and large, not everyone here can be held responsible. Those of us with grey hair, that's off the fashion choice as well nowadays, so it's tricky. So here is that's a defending article, but that would be unfair. Here is the Paris Agreement, this is the final text of the Paris Agreement, and 32-page document, the usual sort of fairly dry thing to read. Have any of you had the pleasure of ploughing through it? Most riveting of reads. And as we've already pointed out, I do think, and I want to emphasise, because I'm going to be fairly critical of some of what's within that and our response to it, that it is an important diplomatic triumph. And I think see this in two respects. Firstly, the idea that pretty much every single world leader came together and said that they think that the climate change science is broadly right is a huge step forward. There's been a very strong set of vested interests trying to unpick climate science, and they've been doing that probably with far more money than the climate scientists have had to actually do the research, to be honest. And in the end, the climate scientists have won out. Government leaders have come together and said, we believe the science. The second triumph, I think, I would say, is wrapped up in this particular paragraph, and there are other triumphs within it as well. But I'm not going to focus on those today. I'm going to focus on the mitigation side in particular. And it's this little paragraph here, which I've blown up to have a look at, just here now. And it says to hold the increase in global average temperature to well below 2 degrees C, well below, not a 50-50 chance of, above pre-industrial levels, and to take efforts, pursue efforts to limit the temperature increase to 1.5 degrees centigrade. It also, very importantly, makes reference now to the, doing this on the basis of the best science, and in the penultimate text, before the final text, that was to be moved. Best science had been removed, and quite a few of us argued it should be put back in. We argued for lots of other things to be put back in as well, but they weren't, but that one at least was included. And I think it's really important that we have that in there, because that gives us, again, a very clear steer as to what quantitative framework we can use to assess our policies. But it also says to do this on the basis of equity. So the really important facets are well below 2 degrees C, and pursuing 1.5 degrees C, and I'll come back to that later. I think that's a bit of a sop to the poor parts of the world. To do this on the basis of the best science, that leads us very clearly to, I would say, the IPCC reports, and probably some updates over periods of time as well. And also to think about issues of equity. So when we think about what that means for our country, to take account, are we one of the wealthy parts of the world? And if we are, then what we have to do should take account of the poorer parts of the world that need some additional emission space and time to deliver the mitigation rates necessary for 2 degrees C. But if you put those together, these allow us to push our paymasters, our leaders, ourselves, our universities, our institutions, very hard indeed. You can quantitatively frame these the policies that we put in place and say, are they in line with what we've signed up to? I take it, maybe think this is naive, at face value, our leaders signed up to this, and in my case, David Cameron signed up to this. I assume he wasn't lying, I assume he meant it, and therefore, on the basis of the best science, I should be able to push along with other people in civil society, our Prime Minister, or in your case, your leaders here, to deliver this policies in line with this, or accept the fact that they're going to renege on the Paris Agreement. Let's be honest and clear about it. There are some very clear issues with the Paris Agreement that are not in there. Firstly, it's a document about climate change. It makes no reference to fossil fuels in 32 pages. Because there was a belief we have to keep everyone on board, and that includes the Saudis. So we couldn't keep everyone on board if you were to mention fossil fuel, which I thought had something to do with climate change. Decarbonisation, also not mentioned in there. Aviation and shipping, that's the equivalent emissions of the UK and Germany added together and growing at a phenomenally fast rate. In fact, if you put those two together, about 14 to 15% of UK emissions are aviation and shipping, and they're not factored into any analysis anywhere, not even to our inventories. So they are exempt again. The INDCs, the voluntary pledges that governments put into Paris before the negotiations, a lot of people have argued they add up to 2.7 degrees C of warming, but actually it's far more than that. They only hold to 2.7 if you make fairly heroic assumptions about what's going to happen after 2030. And remember, the pledges that we put in to Paris only are for the period 2020 to 2030. They're muddled at best, some are absolute, some of them are relative to carbon intensity, there's different base years, so there's lots of, so it's a bit of a muddled mess, and you've got to make your best assessment of what that mess looks like, and then you've got to make certain sets of assumptions about what happens post 2030. So if you assume the same sort of levels of effort post 2030, then you're probably talking about a temperature rise that's well above 2.7, 3.5 degrees C, temperature rise, that sort of level. The INDCs are not going to be reviewed until 200 billion tonnes from now, or 2020. You can measure time in terms of emissions or in terms of chronological time. And that's quite significant. 200 billion tonnes from now is when we review the INDCs that are more in line with 3.5 degrees C. So that CO2 will be in the atmosphere, changing the climate for up to the next 10,000 years. So about 20% of the CO2 remaining in the atmosphere for about that length of time. So that's obviously far too late to really be serious about climate change. There's a fundamental reliance on negative emission technologies, and I'll come back to this one later, but the Paris Agreement completely relies on those, but it makes no reference to them anywhere throughout the 32-page document. But without those, it falls. It doesn't hold. And although I'm not going to go into this side of it at all, I think it is also worth pointing out there's a lot of discussion about this $100 billion per annum that's going to be given to the poorer parts of the world to both adapt to climate change, but also to mitigate, to ensure that their energy systems don't follow the pathway that ours have done. And when you talk about it quite quickly, $100 billion sounds like a lot of money, but I would suggest it's just a crumb. It's a little more than pennies, and I think it's derisory and a sad indictment of our lack of concern for those parts of the world. The subsidy to fossil fuels, according to the IMF in 2015, this is the direct and indirect subsidy, the indirect one being mostly health costs, not climate change costs. I think they only use $30 a tonne for climate change costs. So it's the direct subsidy, the indirect subsidy, was about $5.3 trillion 5.3 trillion. That dwarfs any substitute to renewables, or even substitute to nuclear. That's 53 times more than we are prepared to give the poor parts of the world to deal with climate change. That shows how little we care. Or from a UK perspective, it's about 30th of the UK GDP. That's when we give the poor parts of the world to deal with the climate change impacts that we've decided to hang on to them knowingly, and hope they will actually reduce their emissions as well. So I think it's a sad environment. There's some three papers I've put on here, and this is one of the ones you can run to take a copy. What I wrote, Nature asked me to write a response to Paris, following the Paris Agreement. So it was there. And there's also a pre-edited version there, which I think is a little bit fuller than the Now, before Paris, that's roughly the pathway that we were heading on. For those that are interested, it's about RCP 8.5 or A1FI, if you like, the old scenarios, but you know, that's just the energy scenarios looking forward for emission scenario. We were probably heading for 4 to 6 degrees C, depending on how you interpret these things, and we must be careful not to be over precise about those temperatures. But the IEA had said that we were heading for 6 degrees C. That's a bit wrong for the IEA. It said we're probably heading towards that sort of direction. But somewhere that's it's a fundamentally different planet from the one on which we live, 4 degrees C. So it's nothing like the planet we live on. The INDCs, and different ways of interpreting them, are something like this. About 3.5-ish degrees. Again, there's a lot of uncertainty about exactly what the temperature is. And we have to think, as we build things, as we build power stations, infrastructures, buildings like this. I mean, when was this building constructed?
About 1780 or something.
1780. Well, I guess it'll be here for another 200 years or so. So these buildings are the buildings that we put up are things that we'll be using for decades, if not centuries. It's the same for power stations, not maybe centuries, unless it's a tidal scheme. But certainly for 25 to 50 years for power stations, and if it's a coal and nuclear one, probably relicense it to go even longer. You know, even aircraft and ships, they lock in for 27 years the average life of an aircraft in the West. Then we sell it to Africa, of course, and the designs last probably considerably longer than that. So when we do these things today, any policy we put in place today is a policy we're putting in place for our children and our children's children. It's not something we're putting in place just for today. We have to bear that in mind. We are making policies for the coming century. That's the pathway to 2 degrees C. That's actually based on the interpretation of the 1,000 gigaton pathway for the IPCC table 2.2 and synthesis report. So that's not a particularly good chance at 2 degrees centigrade. So there's a huge void, as you can see, between where we're heading and where we need to get to. The big question to me, and the big political question that emerges out of this short-term period, the nearer-term period, In this particular period, we are not going to deliver the rates of reductions that are necessary to move us from our current trajectory onto the 2 degrees C trajectory without dramatic reductions in energy demand. And that, of course, has political repercussions. And that's the part that none of us are very enthusiastic about. And it's what's unpopular, because we can all talk about nuclear power or wind turbines or solar panels and electrification of our energy systems and so forth, but those things take decades to put in place at scale, decades, literally. And we cannot do those. We can ramp them up far faster than we're doing them now, but we can never ramp them up to a level where you can bring yourself off that curve in time. So in the short to medium term, you have to reduce energy demand or fail on 2 degrees centigrade. And no one likes that message, because it comes home to roost, as I'm going to try and show in the next few slides. Now, this analysis here is for a global picture. Because we are signed up, Ireland is signed up as one of the wealthier countries in the EU, and so is the UK, to stay well below 2 degrees centigrade and to pursue a 1.5 degrees centigrade threshold as well. And the 1.5 is there because the poor parts of the world recognise that 2 degrees C, their impacts will be very significant on those parts of the world, and some of those countries will literally disappear. Even at 1.5 degrees C, the impacts are high, but there's supposed to be quite a big difference between the impacts of 1.5 and impacts of 2 degrees C, and there's some ongoing work to show that distinction between the two. But we've signed up on the basis of equity, so we have to think, what does that really mean for us? So you can go back to the IPCC carbon budgets. Again, as I'm using here, this is the one from the synthesis report. And we can look at current emissions, which are about 36 billion tonnes of carbon dioxide is what we're pumping out in the atmosphere this year and last year. From energy, and about 40 billion tonnes if you include the deforestation emissions as well. So at 5 to 8 years of current emissions, we'd have wiped out the budget for 1.5 degrees C. So by the time that we get to review the INDCs that we all know and every country knew was inadequate that we put into Paris, by the time we review those, we'll have wiped out the lower temperature threshold that is embedded within the Paris Agreement. So in a sense, it held its own demise within the report, within the document. The Paris Agreement undermined its ability to achieve 1.5 by not having a review procedure in 1 year or 2 years' time. Now, whether we did that knowingly or not, I think many of us in the scientific community say we're trying to point this out, but I think many others were not. So I don't know how. It would be interesting to know behind the scenes what really went on and whether the wealthier countries were aware that this was going to be the case or not. So 1.5°C is not achievable, unfortunately. For 2°C, and I've not put all the slides behind this, but you can ask me about it if you'd like to. Again, based on the IPCC budgets, the 66% chance of 2°C is also lost. And let's just remind ourselves what that really means. At 2°C, many people will die. They will be poor, they'll be low emitters, so not part of the problem. They'll be non-white, typically, not all, but many of them. And they live a long way from here. We also know that there'll be a gender issue. So we know when we stress communities, the people that suffer most are the women and then the children. So there is a race dimension, a gender issue, and an age issue related to this that we must not forget. And we have to remind ourselves, we are knowingly doing this and have been for a quarter of a century. So we have the lights on here, because it's nice for us, but know that the impacts on that will be felt by poor people around the globe. 66% chance of 2°C has gone, we've blown that. Now, given that 2°C is dangerous, and I always use this analogy with flying, which hopefully none of us do if we're concerned about climate change. Would you ever go in a plane if it only had a 66% chance of landing safely? You wouldn't, would you? But that's only got 400 people on a plane, or whatever the plane might be. This one's got 7.3 billion people on it. And yet we're prepared to take that risk. We're not even prepared to take that risk. Or at 50% chance of landing safely. That would require us to be in a warlike footing. In the elections you had here recently, was climate change at the forefront of the debate?
Yes.
Of course it is in the EU.
What?
Oh, well, that's good. That's good.
Not many
of the debates.
Well, it needs to be at the forefront of our debates in the UK. Of course, we did discuss it all the time in the UK about the EU, the referendum, so forth. Climate change is there at the forefront of all the discussions. I haven't heard it yet, but maybe we'll be one day. We would have to have a warlike footing. There is nothing like that. We have no sense of climate change being that serious. So that probability has gone. We are now in for an outside chance of 2°C, with all the implications that entails. An outside chance is the best that we have. And my concern, I'll come back to the other concern later slide. So the question then is that actually for policymakers, that's not particularly helpful. We're talking about a global issue, and obviously if you're an Irish policymaker or if you're running a company, you want to say, well, what's that mean for me? Global figures aren't helpful. What does that mean for me as a leader in my country or within a company or organisation? You can work that out, because we're told to do this on the basis of the best science, so you can just do some quite simple mathematics here. We have a carbon budget. Now, there's a range of budgets, and you can look at the range of budgets, but the analysis holds really across the full range. We have a range of budgets for a 33% chance, an outside chance of 2°C. And we take that from the IPCC. We also can estimate, depending on what we assume, for the poorer parts of the world, what their emissions will be from the poorer parts of the world over the coming century, or really over the coming few decades. So we can do that. We get their carbon budget. You literally just subtract number 2 from number 1, and you get what's left for us. That's a very small, very weak equity dimension in there. And we think first about how can the poor people manage to have successful economies and successful societies, and with that, what their emissions would look like, and then from that you work out what would be left for us in the wealthy parts of the world that have caused the problem, by and large, anyway. So let's imagine that the poor parts of the world could peak their global emissions, this is dominated by China, by 2025. Now that is an enormous request, but what I think is viable now, and actually there's an interesting paper out by the LSE just suggesting that sort of time frame is viable. China said 2030, in Paris, India said 2040, a lot of people think it would be quite late. But I think a lot of the changes we're seeing in the global economy at the moment suggest that is a viable peaking date for global emissions. But that in itself, of course, is not enough. You then have to bring the emissions down. But let's imagine they bring emissions down, they have successful mitigation policies, that are reach 10% per annum by 2035. That's three times higher than most economists, or some economists, would suggest it's compatible with economic growth. Three times higher than the Stern Report included. So that is a huge request for these parts of the world. And given that they're growing at some of China, possibly 6% per annum is its latest estimate, that's a 16% improvement in carbon intensity year on year, 16%. Just think what you're discussing in Ireland. I know the Welsh government talking about 3%, and I'm failing on that. They have to fully decarbonise their energy system by about 2050. And that's, when I say that, that's not electricity. Electricity and energy both end in E, or start in E and end in Y, but they're very different. 80% of the energy we consume in Ireland, the UK, most industrialised parts of the world, is not electricity. 80% is not electricity. Only 20% is electricity. And it's much harder to decarbonise the other 80%, and that's probably why you have to electrify it. But this means that by 2050, planes, refrigerators, cars, ships, everything is zero carbon, not low carbon. Low carbon isn't low enough. It has to be zero carbon or your temperature rises will keep going up. So you can work out the carbon budget for that, and you have a carbon budget from the IPCC, you take one away from the other, and you come to the point, what does that mean for Ireland? Well, in terms of reduction rates, and we're reviewing this in relation to the latest IPCC reports and some other work that we've, information we've gotten, of course, the slight slowdown, well, the significant slowdown in emissions over the last 2 years at a global level. We'd have to have at least 10% per annum reduction in emissions, 10% every single year. What are you discussing in Ireland? Nothing like that. An order of magnitude lower, I would think.
Nothing. It's
going up. Going up, well, considerably more than an order of magnitude lower. So starting from now, that's a 50% reduction in emissions by 2020. 50% reduction. I mean, remember, this is across all of your sectors. 75% reduction by 2025, 90% reduction by 2030, and basically, Ireland, along with the wealthy parts of the world, for an outside chance of 2 degrees centigrade, would need to have zero emissions in its energy system by about 2035. So by and large, the wealthy parts of the world have to have been fully decarbonised by 2035, there or thereabouts. This is really pushing the envelope for the budgets a little bit, really should be a little bit earlier than that. And 2050 for the poor parts of the world. So it's a very different message from the one we normally get to hear. What did we submit? What has Ireland signed up to in Paris, along with the rest of Europe? 40% reduction by 2030. Less than half of what is necessary for an outside chance of 2 degrees centigrade. We're one of the wealthier parts of the world. And Ireland in particular, unlike the UK, has an excellent renewable potential as well. How can this be reconciled with these sorts of official accounts? This is Working Group 3 of the IPCC, that's the more political report than the IPCC on mitigation. We've got the science reports, which are much less political. Mitigation costs would be so low that global economic growth would not be strongly affected. Yes. Mother of an apple pie, have your cake and eat it, all that wonderful sort of rhetoric we all like hearing. And the UK account is very similar to that. To keep to 2 degrees C, we must cut UK emissions by at least 80% by 2050. Well, that's got nothing to do with climate change. That's just a random number for 2050. But the good news is that reductions of that size are possible without sacrificing the benefits of economic growth and rising prosperity. So you can see George Osborne smiling all the way to the carbon bank with that. So we all want that sort of future. We all want to think that was the case. And yet that's completely at odds with what I've just tried to show you, which is just applying some basic maths to the numbers in the IPCC report. So just basic arithmetic shows that these are wrong. Now why is it that we are able to say, or how is it we are able to say these things? And these are repeated by the Sterns of this world, by Michael Jacobs of this world in the UK, but lots of people say this idea of the win-win, green growth, that's the way we're going to resolve this problem. And I'll suggest we've left it too late, probably true in 1990, but not true in 2016. The first of these is a negative emission technology called BEFS. It's the most common one that people talk about, and that's biomass energy, carbon capture and storage. By and large, we're going to grow trees or plants, miscanthus, switchgrass, other forms of willow, other things like this, that as they grow will suck CO2 out of the air through photosynthesis, the normal process of growing biomass. We will then harvest that, chip it, put it into pellets, whatever it might be, ship it all the way around the world, and burn it in the world's power stations. That's a fairly major request, or task in itself, to do that. And we're going to get to capture the carbon dioxide from the chimney of those power stations, the best that we can, using carbon capture and storage, catalysts like anyone, scrubbers and so forth. We're going to liquefy the CO2, or at least almost that, to a phase change state, compress it and pump it underground somewhere a long way away and hold it there for a few thousand years. Now that's what we're aiming to do, because we can't be bothered to, as I often point out, to find a way of travelling 6 miles to pick up a newspaper that doesn't rely on 70 kilograms of human being getting in 1,000 kilograms of car. Yeah. Rather than find a way to do simple things like that, or to stand in the room without the lights on, you know, giving a presentation, we are going to do this.
Turn off the lights.
So all I'm saying is, just look at the things we normally are not because I mean, this happens everywhere. At least the curtains are open here. They close the curtains during the daylight, not the lights on. Now, this has never worked at scale. We've never had anything like this at scale. There are huge technical and economic unknowns to this particular policy. Belief. There are huge efficiency penalties, probably 15 to 25% efficiency penalty if you bolted this on the back end of your power station, remembering that most power stations are only 35 to 55% efficient anyway. Then you bolt this on the back end, and then you lose 4 to 6% of the grid before you put it into your very inefficient appliance in your home. So you know, most energy is simply lost through that process. Limited biomass availability, planes expect to use it for flying us around the world, shipping expects to use it, the car industry was already using it in fuel. We're going to be growing food for 9.3 to 9.7 billion people by 2050, and the chemical industry expects to use biomass for a feedstock into its industry as well. So all of that is expected to be grown on a round planet. And we have to have our fingers crossed that in the interim, while we choose to carry on doing very little about climate change, that our ongoing levels, high levels of emissions in the atmosphere will not create a whole suite of other sets of feedbacks that are not factored into the climate models that are sufficiently uncertain to do so, but for instance, the melting of the permafrosts and the releasing of methane into the atmosphere. So we have to keep our fingers crossed these will not become severe and will override the fact that we've chosen to do very little about climate change whilst we await some magician to come up with these technologies in 2050. Just to give some sort of scale on what this looks like, the IPCC carbon budgets for a reasonable chance of 2 degrees C assume planting out an area of 1 to 3 times that of the size of India. As I say on this, that in the UK we probably think it is India because we have a colonial past. But perhaps we could use Ireland. I'm sure we won't be planting it in the UK. We plant that. We're about to take some of your windows because we want to get biomass as well. 1 to 3 times the size of India, year after year, decade after decade. We have to store hundreds of billions of carbon dioxide, just enormous quantities of carbon dioxide, securely underground for 1,000 or more years. Now that is a huge request, and the Paris Agreement is fundamentally premised on that working. And so is the Committee on Climate Change evidence to the UK government. The UK government has carbon budgets in those vaguely enshrined in law. I think the only government in the world that has carbon budgets. So significant credit to it, the budgets are very weak and they rely on that technology working. But if you look at the recent advice to government, the Committee on Climate Change 5th report, only one reference to BECCS and negative emissions is in there, and it's in the footnote. It's much smaller text than the rest of the pages. But all of that looks quite optimistic when you consider the second technology that's required, which is a time machine. Now that sounds quite flippant. What on earth do we mean? No one seriously is thinking the IPCC or advice to governments that we actually require a time machine to go back in time. Well, unfortunately it is, and I'll come back to that in a second. But just remind ourselves here. This is what Feynman said, and this is what I'm trying to say. We are actively, deliberately trying to fool nature. We have taken the view that economics is more important than the second law of thermodynamics. That 15 or 14 billion, whatever it is, 13 to 14 billion, years that we've used physics, not we've used it, but physics has been in existence since the Big Bang, that, you know, survived all that time, and yet we've got these short-term ephemeral economic models that we think now are going to outlive physics. I've got a feeling in the end of the day that physics will win out and that we will fail if we think we're going to fool nature. And there's another paper here talking about the negative emission technologies, so feel free to take that one as well. It was published in Nature Geosciences. So, here's what I'm saying here, flipping. Well, let's look at the IPCC scenario database. There are 400 scenarios in that database. These are future emission scenarios. For a 50% chance or better, 2 degrees C. Of those, 86% include negative emissions. 86%. The other ones that are in there assume global emissions will peak in 2010. And I can't remember the exact number of this, and I remember discussing it with a colleague in Norway, but I think it's somewhere about 70% of the emissions in that particular group include negative emissions and an assumption that we'll peak emissions in the past. And the UK government's policy is based on the UNEP gap report, United Nations gap reports, and in that, around 80% of our scenarios that underpin government policy assume a 2010 peak in global emissions. 2010. So we do require a time machine to fit with the advice that we're giving our governments. So when we think about this, Paris, far too many academics, either they're saying something or they're complicit for their silence, and politicians, rather than focus on urgent and deep mitigation today, which will have hugely profound political and economic and social challenges, now that is going to be very difficult for our society to deal with these sorts of rates of change. Rather than doing that, we're relying on our kids coming up with a non-existent technology in 2050 that will suck huge quantities of CO2 out of the air and store it somewhere safely. Do we think that's a reasonable, reasoned approach? But that's what we're all relying on.